In our last class, we're looking at the fourth sets of verses to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, according to some scholars. So, in this class so far, we're in the beginning of the Seerah, or the biography of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because the surah we're looking at is from the early surah that were revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so early is the revelation of this surah that Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said, أول ما أنزل على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من القرآن سورة العلق. That the first to be revealed to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم from the Quran was سورة العلق. ثم القلم ثم المزمل ثم المدثر. And secondly, القلم, and then المزمل. Thirdly and fourthly, المدثر. So we've mentioned before in previous classes that there's some scholars that hold the opinion that the second thing to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was al-qalam. But the most authentic opinion, the strongest opinion, al-qalam was the fourth thing to be revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Therefore, the ayat or the surah, as we mentioned last week, the verses in surah, they were makkiyah or madaniyah. They're what? The ayat, the verses in this chapter of the Quran, they're makkiyah or madaniyah, na'am. Yes, Salman. Makkiyah. Agreed? Nam Qaisar. Barakallahu feek. They're Makkiyah in the beginning, and after verse 16, they are Madaniyah. And we define what makes an ayah Makkiyah or Madaniyah. The point of confusion from some will be, so what do we call this surah? How do we name it? Is it Makkan or is it Madani? The surah, the chapter in itself. Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he mentioned, إِذَا كَانَتْ أَوَّلُ surah. Or Sadr Surah, Makkiyah. If the beginning of a surah is Makkan, the surah itself is what? Makkan. Or إِذَا كَانَ أَغْلَبْ أَجْزَائِهَا مَكِّيَّةً. If the majority of the surah, or the verses in the surah, or the parts of the surah are Makkiyah, the surah is what? Makkiyah. If the majority of the parts in the surah, the chapter of the Quran, the Madaniyah, فَهِيَ مَدَنِيَّةً. They are Madaniyah. So this surah is Makkiyah, although there are verses in it which are Madaniyah. The surah in itself is what? Makkiyah. And we mentioned last week that this surah served as a ilaj, as a treatment and a medicine for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, tarbawiyah, medicinal in terms of education from that which they accused the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of, such as being majnoon, insane. The denial of the message of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or his prophethood, and the denial of what? The book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in this surah we had ilaj at-tarbawiyyah, medicine and healing for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and whatever followed the path of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ba'da a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. He began the surah with noon. And we said noon, this harf, this letter alone, was part of that treatment or the medicine for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam concerning the what? The ilaj, concerning the denial of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we look at the tafseer, the explanation of noon, and we said ulama, they've disagreed amongst themselves concerning what does it mean, or the interpretation of noon. And we gave four different interpretations. Four different interpretations. We said the first interpretation was the interpretation of the majority of the Salaf of this Ummah. Our forefathers from the Salaf of this Ummah, meaning the Sahaba, Tabi'een, Atba'u Tabi'een, and Khulafa al-Rashideen, such as Abu Bakr Siddiq. And they said, Noon, the tafsir, according to them, is that they say, هذا مما استطر الله بعلمه. These are from the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept as a secret with Him. So therefore, لا نخوض فيه. We do not engage or go into it. And they say, لكل كتاب سر. Every single book, every single heavenly book has a secret. وسر كتاب الله. And the secret of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, هذه الحروف المقطعة. These letters at the beginning of the surah, such as Alif Lam Mim, Sad, Alif Lam Ra, and Noon. So this is one opinion. What is the second opinion, Ya Habib? He wasn't here last week. I remember I was asking him to get any more questions, and he wasn't here last week. Ya Qaisar, what's the second opinion? The second opinion concerning Noon. In which way? Barakallahu fi. We said the Arabs in their kalam or iftitahu kalam, they want to begin a speech and draw your attention. Rather than knocking or banging on a table, they'll use certain letters, which are not normal words. If you speak normal words, people's ears have become accustomed to it. So the Arabs will start ala like this. And they had all the different adawat at tanbih, ways of gaining your attention. But the likes of alif lam mim, they've never heard before. The likes of noon, he gained the intention. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says after that, wal qalami wa ma yasturun. That some of the ulama say adawatu tanbih. Is attention puller or attention gainer? Likewise, from what we mentioned is, some of the ulama, they said it was sent as a challenge to the mushrikeen. That in the same way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks them or challenges them to create a fly, even though all the things that the fly is created from is in front of them, likewise, that which the Qur'an is made from, the letters of the Qur'an, alif, all the way to ya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving it to them and even spelling out to them. Yet they cannot come with the likes of a chapter in the Qur'an or a verse of the Qur'an. Jayid, some of the other scholars, they say that these huruf and muqatta'a, these letters in the beginning of the surah or the beginning of the chapters of the Qur'an, that they are taken from the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Noon is a part of the name of Allah Azza wa Jal, Ar-Rahman. This opinion of some scholars. Some other scholars, they say that Noon is the name of the surah, the chapter itself, or one of the names of the Quran. And the last opinion is Noon is Hoot, a whale. Is there any way, any place in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the word noon? Naam. There's an ayah. Naam. Yunus alayhi salam. That sahibu al-hoot. Noon. That hoot, that will is referred to as what? Noon. That noon that has been mentioned in this ayah is al-hoot, the whale. And some other scholars say the whale which is being mentioned in this ayah is a whale that's greater than the whale that swallowed Yunus alayhi salam. That it was a whale that is so large, كان يحمل الأرض. It used to carry the whole earth. ثم ثبت الله سبحانه وتعالى الأرض بالجبال. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the earth firm with what? The mountains. That's what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the mountains. والجبال أوتادا. We made the mountains as a peg to grip the earth. So these are different at-tafaseer, interpretation of an-noon. After this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَالْقَلَمِ وَمَا يَسْتُرُونَ. Waw in the Arabic language is used for many purposes. So waw could be used for and. Ana wa Muhammad wa Ismail, me and. And waw is also harf min huruf al-qasam, from the letters you use to make an oath or to swear. So wallahi. And the way you know in the Quran, if it's being used to swear by something, end with what? Kasra, e. Wallahi, wal asri, wal shamsi, wal qamari. So waw is from the letters of al qasam that you use to swear. Likewise, there's two other letters, ta and ba. So you said you could say wallahi, or you could say billahi, or you could say tallahi. So these are harf or huruf al-qasam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, wal-qalami. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by something by using this letter. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could swear by whatever it wills from His creation. Because the creation is what? The creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is not asked about His actions. Wa hum yus'alun. As for the rest of creation, they asked. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could swear by whatever He wants from His creation. As for the creation, they could not swear by anything, or it's not permitted to swear by anything except by what? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the reason for that whoever they say swears by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَدْ أَعْطَ ذَٰلِكَ الشَّيْءٍ مُنْتَهَى التَّعْظِيمِ. If you swear by anything other than Allah, you've given that particular thing maximum exhortation. And nothing could be exhorted. It's not permissible to exhort anything akbar to the greatest or the maximum except for who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's not permissible for the creation to swear by anything from the creation. And that's why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in hadith, من حلف بغير الله فقد كفر أو أشرك. Whoever swears by anything other than Allah as disbelieved or as falling into shirk, associate partners of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a major issue, shirk. But it could be major shirk that takes you outside the fold of Islam or minor shirk, depending upon the level of belief. Because there are people that swear that by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they really exhort those things, from the mushrikeen, the polytheists, that they give it maximum exaltation, be an idol, be a saint, be an angel, they give it maximum exaltation. But if a person does so, it is still haram, it's a minor shirk, but it's not major shirk, but it's still a serious affair. So you find many people swearing by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because they claim they exalt Allah azza wa jal. But to prove that people exalt other than Allah azza wa jal by swearing by Him, is that when people swear by Allah, and many people swear by Allah, it's become like a common thing. Every little thing, صغير كبي والله 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 والله. In Kenya, where the majority of the population are not Muslims, almost every single Kenyan non-Muslim African, they know wallahi. They don't say as I said it, they say wallahi billahi, wallahi billahi, wallahi billahi. They don't even know what they're saying. So when they're trying to tempt you, we have these buses, these small illegal buses, like they're trying to tempt you that coming, there's a lot of spaces. Wallahi billahi, wallahi billahi, wallahi billahi, wallahi billahi. Wazika makanisa. There's as much space in this bus as there is space in the church, because the churches are empty. Wallahi billahi. And one of the first words I learned when I went to Nigeria, thinking it was part of our language, was this qasam. I didn't know what it meant. I just remembered hearing it all the time. Wallahi billahi, summa billahi al-azim. Wallahi billahi, summa billahi al-azim. In Arabic, it's wallahi billahi, thumma billahi al-azim. And people don't take it as nothing. But yet these same people, to show how they may exalt other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will lie and swear by Allah. When you say to them, swear by your mother's life, many people pause. They will pause. Swear by an idol, they will pause. Swear by the life of your children, they will pause. But wallahi billah, not an issue. However, it is still better that a person swears by Allah and he lies than swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he is truthful. And that's why Abdullah ibn Mas'ud used to say that لأن أحلف بالله كاذبا أحب إلي من أن أحلف بغير الله تعالى صادقا. I rather swear by Allah and I'm lying than swear by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and I'm truthful. Because if you swear by other than Allah and you're lying, it is a major sin. If you swear by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, even though you're truthful, it's worse than a major sin. It's what? Shirk. And this is a sin Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala la yaghfir. Allah never forgives. Major shirk, never forgive it. And even if it's a minor shirk, depending on how much you exhort that particular thing, it's still greater than what? A major sin. So swearing by other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a serious issue. No one should swear by anything other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you have many Muslims say, well, Kaaba, they swear by the Kaaba. Permissible? Not permissible. You have many Muslims, they say, well, Nabi, they swear by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Permissible? La. Wa hayat ummi, but I swear by the life of my mother. Wa hayat atfali, I swear by the life of my children, lives of my children. Not permissible. So only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can swear by the creation. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears by something from the creation. Say, wal qalami. Allah Ta'ala swears by Al-Qalam. And like we mentioned before, the reason we swear by Allah Azza wa Jalla, and Allah Ta'ala Azeem. We exhort Allah, He's great. So the principle we mentioned in the tafseer, that when Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala swears by something, He swears by that thing because that thing is of one or two things. And what are those two things? Sorry?
Something that's been modified in the Sharia.
Barakallahu feek. something that is being exalted or made great. So Allah Ta'ala huwa al-azim. You're not sure about anything except what is azim. Either that thing is great or that thing has a naf'u, has benefits. So wa-teen, wa-zaytun, that Allah Ta'ala swears by. Either due to their greatness or due to their what? Their benefit. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, wal-qalami. Allah Ta'ala swears by the pen. What pen is Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala swearing by? The ulama, they say, al-qalam, the pen which Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is swearing by, al-qalam al-ladhi kutibat bihi maqadir al-khala'iq. That the pen Allah Ta'ala is swearing by is the pen that which Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala made right to write down the destiny, ordained destiny of the whole creation. This is the pen Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is swearing by. And this is the pen that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam alluded to when he said, وَعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْأُمَّةِ لَوْ اجْتَمَعَتْ عَلَىٰ أَنْ يَنْفَعُكَ بِشَيْءٍ. If the whole nation gathered together to benefit you something, whatever nations may be, they will never benefit you something except that which Allah Ta'ala has written for you. And if they gather to harm you something, they could never do so except that which Allah Ta'ala has written against you. رُفِعَتِ الْأَقْلَامِ وَجُفَّتِ الصُّحُفِ. The pens have been lifted. And these are the pen of Maqadir, of that which Allah Ta'ala has destined. And this is the pen that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned, the hadith saying, كُتِبَ مَقَادِيرَ الْخَلَائِقِ. What Allah Ta'ala is destined for you in terms of wealth, in terms of children, in terms of everything, was written before Allah Ta'ala created the heavens and the earth, before Allah Ta'ala created the heaven and the earth by 50,000 years. So wal-qalami, the ulama, they say, is of tafseer, say it is I. Some other ulama, they say that which Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is swearing by is al-qalam, is the pen which is in the hands of the angels, the pen by which they write down the actions of the servant. As Allah Ta'ala says, وَإِنَّ عَلَيْكُمْ لَحَافِظِينَ كِرَامًا كَاتِبِينَ. That we've appointed for you keepers, keepers that are noble recorders. Or the saying of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, بَلَى وَرُسُلُنَا لَدَيْهِمْ يَكْتُبُونَ. That our messengers are with them, writing down every single thing which they do. So they say, Al-Qalam Huna is the pen which the angels write down the deeds with. The third opinion, and all this shows the greatness of the pen, and the third opinion is, that the qalam is the one in the hands of the ibad, in our hands, the pens which you use today, to show the greatness of the pen. Because it's with pens that knowledge is recorded and kept. The many ulama, they've passed away, scholars in different fields, but yet their work is here today recorded and preserved due to what? The pen. Contracts, covenant is written what? The pen, to show the greatness of the pen. And the fourth opinion is based on a principle of tafsir which you studied before, Abdul Rahim. That when we have many different opinions, which opinion do we take?
When we have many different opinions.
Yes, concern a particular ayah, the meaning of a particular verse. Yeah, Abu Hanifa.
What is obvious?
Tayyib, that's one. But all of this is obvious and all of this is apparent. Ya Qaisar. If you have many different opinions, one, two or more concern a particular verse, so long as those opinions do not contradict each other and one does not have presence over them, you take all of them. And that's why the fourth opinion, they say Al-Adhar, is the most apparent, which is the pen Allah Ta'ala swearing by is all pens. So when Allah Ta'ala says, وَقَلَمِي وَمَا يَسْتُرُونَ, is swearing by the pen by which Allah Ta'ala made write down that which is predestined, the pen in the hands of the angels, the pen in the hands of the human being, وَالْقَلَمِي. So Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is swearing by the pen, and this shows the greatness of the pen. But the reason we don't serve other than Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, there's nothing we should exalt more than who? Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. So when Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala swears by something to show the greatness of that thing, it should only make you exalt who more? The creator of that thing. Do you understand? So if you appreciate the greatness of the creation, you should appreciate more the greatness of the creator. So, if this is the creation, this pen, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala says, لَوْ أَنَّمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ مِنْ شَجَرَةٍ أَقْلَامٍ وَالْبَحْرُ يَمُدُّهُ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ سَبْعَةُ أَبْحُرٍ مَا نَفِدَتْ كَلِمَاتُ اللَّهِ. Allah Ta'ala says, if all the trees upon the face of the earth were to be pens, and the oceans were to support, and you bring another seven oceans, the word of Allah Ta'ala will never become exhausted. So if all the trees on the face of the earth were to be pens, and the seas were to support, another seven seas, the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could never be exhausted. So as much as the pen, we see it's ungrateful, what about the creator Allah azza wa jal? It shows the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in Arabic, anytime you have al-qasam, or in any language, you swear by something, there's always jawab al-qasam, the purpose of why you're swearing, or the answer to that oath. So where is jawab al-qasam? What is the purpose of swearing here? Allah ta'ala swears in order to prove three things. And what are those three things? Ma anta bi ni'mati rabbika bi majnoon. That you're not crazy. And to prove or to make an oath for the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, for him is reward uninterrupted. And lastly, that is of the best of moral character. So Allah ta'ala says, ma anta bi ni'mati rabbika bi majnoon. You are not majnoon by the grace of your Lord. You could say, ma anta bi majnoon. You're not majnoon. But Allah ta'ala added to it what? Bi ni'mati. By the ni'mah, the favor of your Lord. They say the favor of your Lord here is the favor of making him a messenger. Ni'matul risala. And they say he said a favor in order for him to be what? Grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, I could say, ya Abu Hanifa, you're a good man. Or I could say, Abu Hanifa, bi fadlillah. By the bounty of Allah, the favor of Allah, you are a good man. This makes you more thankful to who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is one of the questions that the brothers asked me, that look, we're not supposed to praise people to their faces. But if you praise somebody, say by the favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or if that praise is directly from Allah azza wa jalla, it's different to a human being praising you. Secondly, if somebody doesn't praise you to your face, but you hear your praises being sang and being mentioned, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, هَذِهِ مِنْ الْبُشْرَى. This is from the glad tidings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, al-ajil, advanced glad tidings. That is a reflection of your situation in the hereafter. So you have some people, when they pass away, they are alive, people always mention them good. This is bushra al-ajil, glad tidings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, قَبْلَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. مَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِمَجْنُونَ. You're not by the favor of your Lord, the grace of your Lord, majnoon. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرُ مَمْنُونَ. And for you is a reward which is uninterrupted in this dunya. And how is the reward of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam uninterrupted in this dunya? هُوَ الَّذِي هَدَانَ وَدَلَّنَا لِهَذَا بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ. Is the one that guided us to this path by the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the bounty of Allah. So for every single Muslim who does an act of ibadah, the reward goes to who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like he mentioned, man dala ala khayr, whoever guides to guidance or goodness, he receives the reward of whoever does it without their reward being decreased. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he guided us to this. So now with the amount of Muslims alive and that have passed, for every single thing they do, the reward goes to who? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ajru ghayr mamnoon, that the reward la yanqati', it never ends, nor does it ever cease. Also, this is an advice and a guidance for the Muslims, that whatever good you guide to, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will cause you to receive that reward. So on these social media that we have, advising people, encouraging people to pray witr, if you praise that witr, the reward inshallah ta'ala goes to him, but you take that reward as well, that is reward being decreased. And then he tells somebody else to pray witr, and tells another person to pray witr, or Jumu'ah for example, he says so to somebody, salli ala nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Give salvation upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, he remembers now, Allahumma salli wa sallam ala Muhammad. He tells his children, he passes the message on, he forwards it. For every single person that does that, you receive the reward. Or if somebody accepts Islam, and you teach them the pillars of Islam, or don't even teach it, just accepts Islam, for every single thing he does, imagine from the time he wakes up, Allahu Akbar for Salah. And every single thing, the tasbih, the tahmid, everything he does in his life, you receive that reward. Subhanallah. So if we want our rewards to be uninterrupted, we should engage in this, spreading good so we may receive the reward. Likewise for the youth, take advantage of your youth, the young men here. Because if you take advantage of this youth, your reward will be uninterrupted. Because whatever you do in your youth constantly, and you do it consistently, when you reach old age and you can no longer do it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you as though you're doing it. Like a person who is sick, there's a hadith, he's ill, but before becoming ill,
he normally prays witr, fast Monday, Thursday, the fast of Dawood, does Qiyam al-Layl, does so many deeds. Or he's rich, for example, and before he became impoverished, he used to give a lot of sadaqah. Due to his inability to do so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala still rewards him as though he's doing it. Consistency. So take advantage of this youth, and for us to take advantage of our health. That when we're no longer healthy, and we're saying, subhanAllah, I wish I could do such and such, I wish I could do such and such. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you because you used to constantly do it. After this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلْقٍ عَظِيمٍ. So Allah ta'ala made an oath for these three things, that you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with two assurances, إِنَّ وَاللَّمْ, that verily, verily, you're of the highest moral character. So what was the character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? To summarize, the character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as mentioned by Aisha radiallahu anha, is كَانَ خُلُقُهُ الْقُرْآنِ. His character was the Qur'an, so he followed the orders of Allah Azza wa Jalla in the Qur'an, stayed away from the prohibitions. So whatever you find in the Qur'an is the character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That it was not faddan, it was not harsh, hard-hearted. If it was so, then faddan min hawlik, they would have fled away from you. They would have left you, the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. So soft in character, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was extremely generous. That ma su'ila shay', he was never ever asked for anything, faqala la, and he'll say no. If anything seen on him and somebody said, I like this, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was extremely gentle. He would just give it straight away. That even when the Sahaba used to come to him, he used to say, لو كان عندنا مال بحرين, if I had a wealth of البحرين, لعطيناك هكذا وهكذا وهكذا, we'll keep giving you. That some of the Sahaba used to say, there was nobody I hated more than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he just kept giving me and giving me and giving me and giving me. Because there was nobody I loved more than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was brave, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Everything the Qur'an was a khuluq of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why Aisha radiallahu anha said, كَانَ يَرْضَى لِرِضَاءِ. Whatever pleases it, the Qur'an, it pleases the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whatever angers or is against the Qur'an, it makes the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam angry. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the one that said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتَمِّمَ مَكَارِمَ أَخْلَاقِ. I have been raised to complete or perfect good character. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, مَا مِن شَيْءٍ أَثْقَلُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ مِنْ حُسْنِ خُلُقٍ. There's nothing heavier on the scale يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ than good character. And we said good character first and foremost with who? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not just the creation, that's the most important one. Don't be a mushrik. Good characters and ethics with who? Adab ma'Allah, first and foremost. And then the creation of Allah azza wa jalla. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَبْلُغُ بِحُسْنِ خُلُقِهِ دَرَجَةَ الصَّائِمِ لَا يَفْتُرُ. That a person reaches the position or the status due to his good character, the status of a person that fasts and he never breaks his fast. That stands up in prayer, he doesn't stop praying just due to good character. And this is very important in the beginning of the message. That in the beginning of the message, one of the things that affected the people is the good character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And likewise, when we're giving da'wah, we have many stories from the Seerah, the woman who the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam helped or assisted to carry her goods. And she was saying, have you heard of this man called Muhammad? Or this person called Muhammad? She didn't realize he's a prophet. He's a liar, he's this, he's that. And he kept quiet all the way to assisted her to her place. And in the end, she said, by the way, who are you? She said, I'm that person you've been speaking about. But due to the character of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammadur Rasulullah. Some of the mushrikeen, they used to come and spy and look. They didn't know who the Prophet was. That who is this person? So one of the mushrikeen, when he came, when the Prophet came to Medina, he said, just looking at the face of the Prophet, he said, this is not the face of a liar. And he accepted Islam. Some of the mushrikeen, when they would come to the gathering of the Prophet, they used to ask, Ayyukum Muhammad, which one of you is Muhammad? He didn't have a high chair. He sat with the Sahaba, extremely humble. They didn't know who was the Prophet. So his character, if you want to have good character, that's why being ordered. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. You don't have good character with your wives, with your children, as a manager at work, leader of army, leader of a country, as a friend, as a brother. You never find a better example than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Good relationship with your son, good relationship with your daughter, with your wives. You find it in the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Especially for the fathers, it's very important to be close to our daughters. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very close to his daughter Fatima radiallahu anha. Now when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was passing away, Fatima, she drew close to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what did Fatima do? She cried. Because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam announced to her that he's going to meet his Lord Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he called her again, and she came close to the ears of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she laughed because he gave the glad tidings relating to himself and her in the hereafter. So you'll not find a better father than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You'll not find a more patient husband than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. From many examples of Seerah, you know, that he will not do anything that displeases his wife, be a smell, be a habit, that even that which he loved, honey, when he ate it, because the camps of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the wives of the Prophet, they used to have two camps, the camps of Aisha radiallahu anha and the camps of Hafsa. So one day they noticed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was one of the wives' house, he was eating honey, and they looked and said, look how he's enjoying this honey. You know what we do? We know he doesn't like bad smell. So what we do, if he comes near, he says, what is that smell? So after this, now the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made honey upon himself, haram, he didn't eat honey anymore. You know, he will help his wives in the house, assist them in the house. You know, anything they asked him for, they said he would never ask anything. Illa qal labbaik. I'm here at your service, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Next week, we'll finish with ayah 3-7, which is concerned the Meccan period. And the week after that, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we'll go to the fifth set of surah, which is al-Fatiha. I think that'll be our 12th class. So what we decided to do now, how many months before Ramadan, inshallah? 5 or 6 months. What we're going to do, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, all this we've covered so far, because it'd be very difficult to go through every single surah in the Qur'an and complete. So what we're going to do is, next week will be the last part of the beginning. Thereafter that, we'll move into the mid of the seerah and bring verses relating to it. So we'll do that we've done this now for how many months? About 3 months. We'll do that for 2 months, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. And then the next 2 months, verses relating to the end. So as far as this course goes, we've got how many months? About 2.5 months, inshallah. No, not 2.5 months, about 4 months. In 4 months, we'll complete, inshallah ta'ala. Is that okay with you? So at least there's an end goal. Yes? Inshallah ta'ala. And barakallahu feekum. Any questions, inshallah?